Viewers, and welcome to the latest episode of The Huddle. I'm Tim Poole here, editor of Gambling Insider, and I'm with Annie Osborne, business development director at Freemarket, and Liz Wilton, business development manager at Freemarket. Guys, thanks for joining me. I thought a great way to start would be if you could tell us a little bit about your roles at the company before we get into the details later on.
Thanks for having us, Tim. My name's Annie Osborne. I'm business development director here at Freemarket. Myself and Liz look after the gaming vertical, and I'll let Liz do her intro.
Hi, I'm Liz, and I work for Freemarket as a business development director as well. Going to be excited to attend ICE next week.
Yeah, pleasure to have you guys on. Please look forward to ICE. We're going to cover a lot of topics within payments, a lot of topics within gaming that kind of cross over. I wanted to start off with by asking about the challenges faced by gaming companies when it comes to banking and payments. And, you know, from my perspective, gaming is often viewed as a kind of a higher risk sector.
Yeah, this is where I think it is unfair that they are limited in options in terms of payments and banking, because in terms of the regulation and the licensing, you know, the strictness around it, they are in fact asked to jump through more loops, I guess, than a lot of other industries. So I feel that they are unfairly prejudiced in when it comes to finding, you know, operational resources such as banking and payments. I also feel that some of the challenges they face are being unfairly priced as a result of this. So, you know, when they're deemed higher or medium to high risk, people in our space feel they can charge them so much more than they really need to be paying for a basic operational tool to run their business.
Yeah, and Liz, do you, I don't know if you have any thoughts on that topic.
Yeah, I'd say traditional banks are just often traditionally hesitant to provide the services, which give limited options for casinos, sports books, and our gambling industry. There's always regulatory complexity. So I guess to address these challenges, gambling companies often are needing to work with sort of specialized gambling focused financial institutions because they are branded in that higher riskier category, even though they do have all the regulation. So these sort of fintechs often have, I guess, more understanding of the compliant operations of a gambling company and just make it a bit easier to navigate.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I think that specialist compliance team that sits behind everything is so important in order to be able to service the gaming industry.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know if this next one is a hypothetical or a trickier question, but if there is a sudden kind of change in risk appetite with banks, what do gaming companies, how does it affect them? And is there any way to kind of preempt that kind of thing?
I think banks are traditionally seen as reliable, but they often have quite a low risk tolerance for gambling. So I'd say, you know, you've got to have a lot of regulatory scrutiny sort of around your company. Banks are going to be constantly quite risk averse and checking all the regulatory environments, which are constantly changing in gambling. It's constantly evolving. So I think having a really good banking relationship with multiple different banks to reduce sort of anything that comes up with regulatory changes and constantly keeping them updated about sort of what you're doing.
It is about having that resilience model in place. You know, if somebody, you know, you may well be banked with, I don't know, X bank, for example. And if overnight their risk policy changes, you are all of a sudden left without any access to your funds, any ability to pay salaries, any ability to receive funds in, you know, from your customers. So what Freemarket's done is they've developed this resiliency banking model, which means you are connected to multiple banks. So should one of ours, for example, on the network decide to change their risk appetite, you will not be left as a business without the ability to access your funds and continue to operate as a business. You know, that's what we know in terms of where we were looking to help companies in this space be, you know, better protected from a risk perspective. Liz is absolutely right.
Mm-hmm. So from those two answers, what I'm hearing is certainly, so as you say, being connected with kind of multiple banks, but kind of transparency and being open about what you're doing as well is helpful.
Yeah, I'd say maintaining your transparency is really important. You know, being able to demonstrate and that transparency to compliance and, you know, all the regulatory standards, being able to adhere to them and show you're adhering to them, and addressing any concerns that are related to any regulatory scrutiny, and just keeping that real transparent, open relationship with your bank and not being afraid. But again, I think, like Annie said, it's having that really, so sort of exploring any alternative banking solutions. You always want to have, you know, an additional option, not being stuck with one, and then having a financial institution which specializes in gambling. So, you know, they have that higher risk tolerance and a better understanding of the sector, and they're keeping up to date, yeah. And in front of all the regulatory changes.
So you've both mentioned resilience and the kind of resiliency model. With so much changing all the time in regulation and new hurdles all the time, and, you know, not just in payments or gaming, but across all technology, how does one demonstrate resilience?
So, you know, making sure that you know what's coming with up to the market industry knowledge, understanding what the customers are asking for moving forward, you know, what do they need in terms of what you need to have on your product roadmap as a financial institution or as a payment provider or a banking partner, what do you need to be able to preempt the customer will need further down the road? So it's not just about the resilience piece of having to manage the risk appetite that's always changing throughout the gaming industry. It's about knowing what's coming and what's needed to accurately service those businesses as they look to grow into different jurisdictions.
Payments is a very broad term. I've mentioned payments a lot myself, but my understanding of payments compared to what you guys understand of it working deeper in the industry, there are whole subsections. What bespoke part of payments would you say Freemarket falls under, and how do you aim to stand out? Because obviously it's still very competitive.
Whilst we sit in the payments space, we are an account provider. We do not sit in the acquiring space. We do not sit in the card issuing space. Not to say that it's not something we couldn't add further down the road, but I think what makes Freemarket stand out is that, you know, whilst we sit under the umbrella of payments, put quite simply, we provide cross-border payments and bank-to-bank B2B only payments.
And what sets us apart, I'd say, is the resilient model. We keep going back to the resilient banking model, and it's supported by multiple prominent partners. So this is always ensuring your robust structure that's capable of adapting to our dynamic risk landscape that the gambling industry is under. So, you know, in the event of any unforeseen changes to your current bank's appetite, we can always seamlessly transition your accounts to a different partner. There's no additional onboarding, which is, as I'm sure a lot of you are aware, a headache. So that's always ensuring continuous and uninterrupted services, which are very important for us all.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I've got a final topic for you both. I always like to look ahead to end our podcast and our interviews. And quite simply, I wanted to ask, and I can ask the question to you both in either order, whichever it is fine. What are your outlooks for 2024, both from a Freemarket perspective, but also what maybe gaming companies can expect? I'm wary now of saying in payments, because as we've said, there's so many different parts of it, but generally in that area.
Yeah, I think one of the things we're going to see is, you know, the continuation of the integration of cryptocurrencies. I know it's been a hot topic for a few years, but the cryptocurrencies into the gambling industry, I think, is going to continue, providing alternative payment methods, and also, you know, being I think the regulatory landscape there for cryptocurrencies is going to, you know, impact their widespread adoption a little bit, but I do think it is for the best.
Absolutely. And also, you know, we see the ever-increasing demand of additional products and currencies that are requested throughout the gaming space, as well as the other verticals that we cover. So we have products on the roadmap and additional banking providers that we're looking to bring on board for the remainder of 2024 and beyond.
Mm-hmm. Well, Annie and Liz, thank you both so much for your time and for your answers. Enjoyed speaking with you. Good luck at ICE and good luck at everything you're doing for the rest of the year.
Thank you so much. We'll see you there.